Welcome to this video coverage for, it is round 9, right? Yes, round 9 of the Gashimov Memorial. Also, it's the penultimate round. So the all-important round that sets the picture for the final games tomorrow. So what I'm going to look at is the game Caruana with White against Mamedyarov. The two other games were Rajabov Carlsen and Kayakin Nakamura. Both of those games ended in draws. Rajabov Carlsen was a very, very long game, more than 100 moves. And most of these moves, starting from, about move 40, were in a very, very close position where Carlsen was trying to do something. He had a very, very little symbolic advantage, but never really, no real winning chances whatsoever. So it ended in a draw. Kayakin Nakamura was somewhat, to my surprise, a King's Indian. Kayakin went for a closed opening with, I think he played d4. Or was it knight f3? Not sure, but we had a King's Indian. Most of the game I liked Nakamura's position a bit better, but at the end it was still a draw with precise play by both sides. So the game that I will look at in more depth here in the game of the day is Caruana Mamedyarov. Let's see what happens. And we got a Slav defense again, really. In a way, together with the Grünfeld, the most popular opening nowadays. I think it's a bit of a shame that in this tournament, which is in memory of Vuga Gashimov, that absolutely no one has played the modern Benoni up to now. I mean, because this has really been Gashimov's trademark opening, and no one went for that. Well, okay, there is a final round, and maybe someone's got the heart to play that. Would be very nice. Okay, so a Slav here with 4e3, the slow Slav, as it is very often called. Yeah, very much due to the fact that White has problems getting something here. And here this is very solid, the following lines. And even there's also e6. Where also White is struggling to do something. With e3, White is avoiding both of these lines. Okay, you can state that why not e6 after e3? Of course, that's a playable move, but it's probably a little bit imprecise here, as White is not forced to go to a semi-Slav. He can also play other moves, especially b3 is interesting, aiming for this type of setup. We have seen this setup various times, and various is a bit much, I think two or three times, in the Candidates tournament, where it was played by Kramnik, and I'm wondering, this game that Arnand, there was a game with Arnand Black also with a setup, bishops on b2 and d3. Yeah, and here Black is committed to c6 already. So e6, while being playable, of course, it's not considered to be a completely reliable line compared to others. So Mamedyarov is going for bishop g4 here. Earlier in the tournament, we had seen bishop f5 here, or a6, knight c3, bishop f5. These are the main lines nowadays. Bishop g4 is also here, played today, is also one main move. Of course, it's the typical idea that Black wants to develop his bishop outside of the pawn chain, so he does not have any problems with it on c8. However, the drawback to that is, well, if you send your bishop to an adventure, it might get lost or caught. And quite often you must give up the bishop, giving White the bishop pair. We see that Mamedyarov follows an interesting idea. After this, and queen b3, he went queen b6. and now Caruana played knight h4. This is a known line for a number of years, and here a recent trend is for black to play the funny move g5. And yeah, this is a move that, let's say 40, 50 years ago, probably would have raised quite a few eyebrows, because it was very uncommon in those days to move the g pawn early and use flank pawns to influence the game early. But in fact, this g5 move, it makes some sense. It wins a tempo on the knight. The knight must retreat. Well, theoretically, white can play g4, but it's not really good. Knight f3, and now h6. So black has gained those moves. There's the possibility sometimes to fianchetto, and you have gained some space while securing your bishop. Yeah, black is not giving up the bishop pair early. So this might look a bit unconventional, but it seems to be a good way to play. Knight e5. This is interesting. Of course, white is intending to maybe take here on g6. We've seen something like that earlier in the tournament. I think it was Nakamura playing black right who got this position with f takes g6. Not 100% sure. I would need to look it up. But okay, Mamedyarov wants to avoid that altogether, quickly exchanging the knight, or let's say inviting an exchange. And Caruana refused that. He just retreated the knight to d3. This is a very important move. It's pretty obvious to a strong player, but it is very common for less experienced players to very often exchange far too much. If they see an exchange, they often go for it, thinking that, okay, I exchange something, it probably will make my life easier. And less complicated means less chances to make a mistake. But that's really a wrong approach. Very often, it is better to not trade pieces, especially if you consider this type of position. White is enjoying a space advantage here with the central pawns. And it would only help black if white would take. You have exchanged the strong knight on e5 against the knight on b8 in essence. So it's not a good idea to do that. Just retreating keeps the tension and asks black, okay, where are you going to put your knights? And quite often the sort of regrouping that the other side must do with all those pieces crammed on little space takes so much time. It does not really matter that white has moved this piece, in this case a third time. Okay, bishop g6, h4, rook g8. Yeah, of course, black didn't intend to castle short anyway, so rook g8 makes lots of sense. Got this trade, and bishop d2. Yeah, here Mamedyarov decided to clarify the situation in the center. He took on c4 and played queen a6, getting rid of the queens, which, as mentioned, makes lots of sense. Black is slightly cramped. He's got those pawns all relatively far back, and white has some space advantage, so you want to trade. Yeah, white cannot really avoid the queen trade. If he moves the queen away, he just... Oh, wait, b7 is hanging. Need to think about that quickly. But there's knight b6, so black can just take here and win a piece. I was briefly irritated by this possibility, but there is knight b6, covering a8 and preventing any checks. So after queen a6, white must allow a queen trade. He did so with knight c1, traded knight b6, and knight a to d7. Yeah, white is occupying some space in the center. Bishop e7 and knight b3. Oh, this looks very very natural. The knights here are positioned to cover the center, and black is eager to gain some space, so he's attacking the center directly with f5. This was not strictly necessary, but I think it's a good move. It's maybe it's very direct and active, so you need to be very precise after that. Black could also easily have been going for something less enterprising, let's say castles, king b8, just sit and wait. Maybe this was easier to play. However, objectively speaking, f5 is okay. f3, white supports the center. And a5. Trying to push the a-pawn to disturb white a bit. And also, this way, you make some use of your rook at the moment. Yeah, acknowledging that you're probably not going to castle long. You use your rook just from the initial square and push the flank pawn. This can very often be a useful device if you recognize that castling is not really helping you much and you want to do something with your rooks. Then pushing the flank pawns, a-pawn, h-pawn, can be a good idea at times, especially if you attack something or you're gaining space to create weaknesses. Here you can attack the knight, and white feels obliged to prevent that. He plays a4, just physically stopping the advance. Yeah, and now the next couple of moves by Mamedyarov are really, really interesting. Here I would have expected to see g4 being played. It looked like the logical follow-up to me to this f5 idea. Black just advancing further, trying to exchange the pawns to get rid of all the weaknesses. I just thought that this should be very close to being equal. If we consider, I'm not quite sure what white is doing now, maybe long castles, king f2, I don't know, probably a king move to connect rooks. And I thought that black then could simply trade here, maybe even here. Yeah, knight e4 could be a bit tricky, but still. Or let's say you play this here even. Just going for exchanges here in the center, opening up the position also a bit against the king. And this is what I expected. He played e5, however. Very ambitious move. Yeah, white took on f5. Yeah, and the next move was really, really astonishing. I was completely taken by surprise to see that Mamedyarov now didn't take on f5. This looks totally normal, just recapturing. But he didn't do that. He went to f7. Yeah, if he would have taken here, I think that black's position should be okay. I don't really see anything dramatic happening. It's very important to note that after knight e4, attacking the a5 pawn, black does not really need to fear this. You can just play knight d5 and operate with this idea, knight b4, threatening knight c2. And this seems to guarantee black about equal play. For example, if white grabs here, you can just continue in active fashion with g4, exchanging here a weakness and keeping this idea in reserve. White does not really have anything great. If he secures this bishop again, black will probably take and play knight b4. Yeah, and this threat is really substantial. White probably needs to do something like that to cover c2. And after capturing and getting the pawn back, it's very much clear that black shouldn't have any serious problems. There are only three pawns left, and there's no nothing concrete going on, especially considering the bishop pair. The bishops don't do much here. Simply too much traded. Yeah, however, he didn't take on f5. He went to f7, which is really strange. I mean, yeah, here Caruana had, I think, a good chance to establish a quite tangible advantage. Here d5 was possible, but he didn't do that. Of course, white needs to do something about the knight. What he did is he played bishop d1 to cover it, just to show what happened. Instead, d5 was quite good. The idea is then, after this, for example, white takes on a5. Yeah, and now we are in a situation where white is a pawn up, and where is the compensation? White is also threatening just to play g4, keeping the f-pawn and making a protected passer out of it. And well, black simply has no compensation whatsoever. And this also applies to other responses. If black takes with the pawn, for example, there is knight b5. a5 hangs, this is threatened. And also there's the positional threat of g4, keeping the f5 pawn as a protected passer. It's just very good for white. Not quite sure why Caruana rejected d5. After bishop d1, what he played, Mamedyarov was able to play knight c4. And this is, in fact, probably, if at all, only very slightly better for white still. Black is just active and has chances to regain the pawn. Knight e4 was played, and now he went for g4, a very active move. Not the only one. Instead of g4, there were other possibilities. He also could have taken here, which is not a bad idea, getting the bishops. And after that, only taking on d4. Or let's say king takes, you can also castle long. I think this should be quite okay for black. However, what he did is also not bad. g4, getting rid of this weakness, also makes lots of sense. White played bishop c3. Note that the capture is answered by this move. And now it gets a bit tricky for white. There is this threat, knight d1, bishop b3. And if the bishop moves, that's probably necessary, bishop c2. Then black can take on g4. And this activity is very nice for black. Should be at least equal. So this is what Caruana played. After that, we got the straight and long castles. Yeah, how to assess the position? Yeah, white enjoys an extra pawn, but black's position is not bad, really. He's got active pieces, yeah, and a pretty healthy structures, though these pawns are not weak. These will probably trade, and the f pawns, well, they need some protection from white, so I think black should be quite okay here. We also see that in the following moves, after king f2, trades, and knight c5, that black really has got active play in the center. Bishop e2. Yeah, and here in this position, black also could have kept the tension here with a move like, let's say, rook g8, but he decided to do something, directly, something tactical in a way. He captured on e4. Check. And went for knight d2. And it seems that this is probably playable. Instead, there also was the idea to play bishop c5 here, going for a pin. And after, let's say, rook d1, black can try to get the a pawn. I mean, black has some activity here. That was a playable option. The problem here is always that these pawns are dangerous. The game continuation, knight d2, I think was a bit better. Yeah, Caruana captured this. He also could have played bishop f3. Maybe this was the better move. It's tough to analyze, very complicated. Black after that can try something like that, taking. And then c5 and rook d3 with some activity. That's really very tough to calculate. Black has quite some counter chances with the two bishops, but it's probably better for white, this line. This is what Caruana played, and after rook d4, king e3, bishop c5, it looks really a bit scary. But it still seems to be okay for white. Bishop c3 was played.
Check.
And now rook g3 check. Yeah, he also could have taken on a4. Check. This looks like a very tempting move. But after king f4, in fact, it turns out to be not so great. Here, black's active rook will be exchanged, and those pawns supported by the king will decide the game for white. So not a really a good option. What he played check. Was perfectly okay. He gave the check here, king f2, And now the exchange sacrifice on c3. This bishop was just too strong. It is perfectly playable though. White takes.
Check.
And rook e4 with a check. Yeah, and now we've got equal material in pawns, yeah, three pawns each. But black is an exchange down, but has very good chances to catch at least one of the loose pawns. We see that after king e1, yeah, not ideal, but there wasn't really a good alternative. You go here, you run right into this idea. Yeah, so he went back, bishop here, and rook h2. And here, exactly here, is probably the decisive moment of this game. After rook h2, Mamedyarov now went for rook e5. And it seems that this is simply not sufficient to get a draw here, which black still probably can do with bishop d6. In fact, it was possible to get a position where maybe it is enough for an exchange. Rook g2, for example, need to cover here, of course, and then bishop e5. Yeah, this is just very active, those pieces. And yeah, what is white supposed to do now? Yeah, it's got this pawn hanging, and yeah, we can try some moves. King d2, for example. Okay.
Check.
And this is certainly not too great for white. You can try to cover like that, but after a move like rook e3, this idea is renewed, and yeah, white does not really have anything great available here. King d2, that's bishop f4. Yeah, very tricky position. Well, white can try to push the pawn. Yeah, trying something like that. Now you cannot go here, as this square is simply protected by the rook. So after f6, black should probably take here, and after
check, check.
After this, we come to a drawn endgame. I think this was probably the crucial moment. Bishop d6, with the idea to get the bishop to e5, probably would have drawn the game. After rook e5, however, there was f6. And now this is very dangerous, this pawn. Black really has no choice. He must get the pawn. And this is only possible with this exact sequence of moves.
Check.
And now white trades the a pawn for the f pawn. That's unavoidable, really. If black wants to keep this here, let's say he plays b6, then white has his check and plays f7, intending rook d1.
Check.
Yeah, this was played. And now bishop h4. We see that now we get exactly the described trade. Yeah, and here the problem is that white will relatively quickly get his rooks coordinated and attack the black pawns. This is probably a position that you cannot hold.
Check.
We see that Caruana manages to activate his rooks, and now he coordinates both rooks to attack the weak spot in black's camp, the b7 pawn. Yeah, it only continued for a couple of moves from here. King b8, rook f7, bishop c7, rook b4, and
check.
Here, Mamedyarov resigned. He cannot prevent b7. From being captured, and there is no resistance anymore. So Caruana won this game, a very tough battle, mostly fought with concrete calculation, where somehow Mamedyarov didn't find the most precise continuations around here. Certainly also influenced by time travel. Some things are still quite remarkable. Moves like bishop f7 here, when just bishop f5 looks totally normal. Quite interesting to see this bishop f7 idea. Okay, so let's just quickly assess this in terms of the overall tournament situation. With this win, Caruana is on +2 and has joined Carlsen in the lead. Carlsen, of course, also on +2. And the good thing is they play against each other in the final round. Carlsen now having the white pieces after he had lost with black in the first turn. Certainly very eager to win this game with white. I'm pretty sure he wants to win this event outright, and also he wants to even the score with Caruana, who had ended Carlsen's very long streak of unbeaten games. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed the coverage here for the 9th round. I'll be back tomorrow, of course, probably with the game Carlsen Caruana. It was very would be very disappointing if we wouldn't get a great fight tomorrow. Okay, thanks for watching. I'll be back tomorrow.